Hello, friends, and welcome to First Congregational Church of South Portland, Maine. I'm Reverend Estelle Margeronis, and it is a joy to see you, whether you're here in person or watching at home, online in real time, or on delay. We're happy to have you with us. Today is a Communion Sunday. If you did not pick up your elements on the way in, you can make your way to the foyer to get your elements. We have the little individual size portions of the cup and the bread, and which is gluten-free bread, by the way, for those of you here. If you're watching at home, you can use whatever you've got at hand, coffee, English muffin, or juice and bread, if that's what you've got. That would be terrific. So happy to have you here today. Friends, together, each week we remember something really, really important. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We are a Christian community, loving, serving, welcoming. If this is one of your first few times here with us, I'd like to let you know that there are exits to the rear of the sanctuary, also over here on your left, and the restrooms are just out that door across the hall. All children are welcome to go to Sunday school, even visiting children, and we just ask the parents go and get them signed in so that we've got your contact information. Friends, I invite you to join me in the call to worship. Enter into this peaceful time of prayer and praise. All are welcome here. Enter into this space of joy and blessing. All are welcome here. And now let's together join and sing our opening hymn, Christ Be Our Light. It's in the back of your red hymnal, number S13.
Thank you. Now let's take a moment and share Christ's peace with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you. Share that same peace with those sitting around you and those sitting at home through that camera right up there. For my message lesson moment for all ages this morning, I want to tell a story about light. And we're going to hear a little bit more about light from Reverend Estelle in a bit, but I want to talk about light and an experience I had with it. Some of my friends and I, well, I love to go backpacking. It's one of my favorite pastimes. And we were out for just an overnight trip backpacking together in early November, 8 or 9 years ago. There were leaves that had, they had all just started falling off the trees, and it was starting to get cold, but wasn't quite cold yet. It was a long-sleeve t-shirt kind of day. We were hiking for a number of hours, and when we got to the top of the mountain, it was amazing. It was gorgeous, and we got caught up in the moment, so before we knew it, it was starting to get dark and starting to cool down a bit more, so we rushed to collect water, to set up our tents, and to start a fire. But while we had enough wood to get us going, we didn't have enough wood to keep a fire going long enough to get us through much of the evening at all, and as much as we would have liked to have gone to bed at 4:30 in the afternoon, couldn't quite bring ourselves to do it. So we started going out from the campsite to gather firewood, and it continued to get darker and darker, and at one point, and we would gather some and bring it back to the campsite, and it was an ongoing team effort as we got ready for the evening to get colder and colder. And at one point, I found myself out in the clearing where the pond at the top of the mountain sat. And I just got caught up in the moonlight and the way it glinted off the water. And when I turned around to go back to the campsite, maybe it's because of the fact that suddenly I was facing away from the bright light of the moon. I don't know, but it was dark. I mean, really dark. I couldn't see anything, especially when I considered going back into the trees to the campsite. But as my eyes started to adjust, there was an orange-red glow all of a sudden, just tiny at first, and it grew in intensity as my eyes adjusted. It was the campfire that my friend had started while I had been moon-gazing that evening, and you know he and my another friend of mine were gathered around it, warm and comfortable, drinking cocoa, and it was a wonderful evening. But I was beginning to lose hope before I saw that light. It's too dark. It's getting cold. Where am I? How are we going to get through tonight? And then the light gave me a new confidence. It reminded me that I was going to be okay. And in the same way we can be lights for one another, same way Christ calls us to be lights for one another, to remind one another that we are going to be all right. It may not be as warm as we'd like it. It may not be an easy go of things, but we're not alone. And we can give a little bit of warmth and comfort and confidence to one another. So it's just one other way to think about light that I wanted to leave you with today. And now, I know we have at least one youngster. I know you're all young at heart, but we have at least one youngster here today that I would invite to come with me to Sunday school.
Already went.
Okay, well, I'm going to go after him then. one way to do it.
Something special about the vibrations of the music, especially the piano, feels almost holy, doesn't it? And then we just remember that we're just vibrating, lots of atoms vibrating together. And our thoughts and our prayers go all the way up to God, just like the music does. Please join me in the prayers of the people. May the love of God surround us. May the peace of Christ comfort us. May the strength of the Holy Spirit sustain us. O Lord, hear our prayers. Each week in worship, we pray together, joining our hearts and our minds and our joys and our sorrows, knowing that when others walk with us and help us to carry those sorrows, they're not as heavy upon each of us. And knowing that when we celebrate, it's just celebrated exponentially when others share in that joy. So together, we lift up our hearts to pray for all who have been displaced or hurt due to extreme weather. Cold this weekend was something else. And we give thanks to God for places that were open to provide shelter and warmth. We give thanks to God for our own places of shelter. And our communities, our connected communities that sustain each of us. We give thanks to God as we pray for all who have received recent diagnoses, that the diagnoses are even possible. Thanks be to God. Treatment is possible. We give thanks to God that surgeries, procedures are possible. And we ask God to be with all who are recovering from recent surgeries, all who are undergoing treatments, all who are waiting for answers. We pray for all who are in hospice this day and all the people that love them. We pray for those who feel like they're dealing with just too much. One more thing will be that last straw. God, lift that straw. Lift all those things from people. We pray for the people of the Ukraine and all nations experiencing war. We pray for all victims of gun violence. We pray for all marginalized communities. We pray for those who are struggling of any kind of struggles, financial, emotional, physical. We pray for those who have been affected by COVID-19 and any illness here and around the world. We pray for our medical professionals and caregivers, our country, and we pray for all of those who grieve. We give thanks this day for connection. We give thanks for this beautiful church community. We give thanks for technology, allowing those who are not here in person to be here with us in spirit, in real time, and on delay. We give thanks for beautiful music. We give thanks for voices that raise song and prayers to God. We give thanks for hands that do Christ's holy work. And we give thanks for the sacrament of communion that we'll celebrate in a little while, today a little bit differently than we have in the past. We give thanks that we can join together to be in union with one another and with God. And now let's take a moment in sacred silence to raise up that which goes unsaid, but which nonetheless rests upon your heart and your mind. Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers for healing. Hear our prayers for hope. Hear our prayers for connection. Hear our prayers of praise and gratitude and thanksgiving. Hear our prayers this day and always, O Lord. We pray this and all of our prayers in the name of the one who came here to earth to live as we do and who taught us to pray using words like these. Our Father and Mother in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And from prayer to prayer, because we can never have enough of that, connecting our hearts and our minds to God again, please join me in the prayer for illumination. Open our hearts and minds, O Lord, by the gift of your Holy Spirit, so that as the word is read and proclaimed, we may hear what you have to say to us today. Amen. Today I read to you from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and then place it under a bushel basket. Rather, they put it on the lampstand so that it can give light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give praise to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until it's all accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And here ends the reading. Jesus calls his followers the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Now, salt and light are two things we use every day. Who's got salt in their kitchen? Yeah, of course. Who's got salt on their table? Right? We use it every day, pretty commonplace. Light. Is there anyone here that doesn't have light switches in their house? Okay. Back in biblical times, salt and light, as used as they are today, were used and thought of as precious because salt was expensive. Do you know Roman soldiers were even sometimes paid in salt? In fact, it was called white gold. Super expensive. And it would be used to preserve things, right? Anybody ever had salted cod? Yeah, you want to wash it off a few times before. I didn't know that the first time I had it. Oh, boy. If you go to the main diner, by the way, in Wells, you can get their cod cakes. They're made with salted cod. They are yummy. So salt was a preservative back in the day. It also was a flavor enhancer. And as Christians, it's up to us to preserve all that Christ stood for. And that means preserving the language of faith. And it means by sharing our faith with others so that they can see us putting our faith into action. In Christ's time, I also want to let you know that salt was also used for religious functions and as a bond of a commitment. In the book of Judges, salt was thrown on the ground of a conquered city, perhaps to ensure that nothing new grew there, right? If you want to get rid of something, throw some salt on it, and whatever's underneath it'll die. Jesus says, if the salt has lost its saltiness, it's not good for anything except to be thrown on the ground. And I believe that if we as Christians fail to enhance or preserve things for the benefit of the world, then there is also a sense of loss and ruin. Throw it on the ground. It's no good. Light was perhaps the most precious commodity in the biblical world. Just like Pastor Steve was talking about, out in the woods, 4:30, it's dark, you can't find your way anywhere, it's cold. Light in biblical times wasn't as easy as the flick of a switch or the turn of a knob. Light in biblical times was only in the daylight, or if you had a little clay oil lamp with a wick, and olive oil would fuel those lamps. Olive oil was super expensive. In fact, it was several times more than the cost of wine. So these were precious, precious commodities, just like you are precious in God's sight, precious and loved. Think back to the last time you lost power, perhaps this weekend, perhaps a few weeks ago. It was dark and cold, right? 4:30? Did you stumble over your sneakers? Did you get hip-checked by a doorknob? It's one of my favorites. Count the bruises after a blackout. Did you accidentally knock something off a table, reaching? One small match in the darkness helps to dissipate all of that, helps us to orient ourselves, right? Light helps us to understand where we are in relation to others and to things. Look how dangerous it would be if it were dark in here right now. Think back to Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve right here in this very room. And we shut off all the lights, and we turned on all those little candles, and all I could see from here was a sea of candles. It wasn't just one or two little lights. It was all these little lights, all of you shining your light in the darkness. And it was a really beautiful thing to behold. Light, it's precious, precious to us today. How many of you take out a light in a restaurant, take out your phone to read a menu? I do. Oh, I do. I'll be the first one to say it. We are the light of the world, not one tiny flame, but lots of them put together. We as Christians, the light of the world. Each week, I close the service with similar words. I might add something to them. I might take away something. I might switch them up a little bit. But every week, you've heard me say these words. Live the light. Anybody know the rest? Give the light and bring heaven to earth every single day, right? That's my version of what Jesus says here. Jesus says, people do not light a lamp and put it under a bushel basket. Rather, they put it on a lampstand, and it gives light to all of the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. See, it's not just about doing the good things, but doing them motivated by your faith and doing so that others may see those good works and they may also give glory to God. This happened last week. I expect some of you saw this story. It was an incredible story out of Massachusetts, and I used to live there, so I know exactly where this happened. A man coming back from the airport was driving in a snowstorm, and he noticed a car driving from the slow lane, crossing over several lanes on 93 North. And that car went off the road into the ditch by the median. This man got out of his car and ran across four lanes on 93, the highway, which is like the turnpike here. Adolfo Molina saw that the driver's head was tipped down. She was unconscious. And he had to run in a snowstorm to keep up with that car. And he was trying to open the door, but it was locked from the inside, so he couldn't get in. As I understand it, as the car started to veer back out onto the highway, he pushed it back toward the median, and eventually the car hit a divider and came to a stop. By now, the police were called, and they were able to use one of those special glass hammers, and they broke the window so they could get in and rescue the woman, and she was given medical attention. We only even know about this because somebody in another car was filming it. It's been viewed over a million times, that video. And in a TV interview, Adolfo's cross was prominent on his jersey. And his wife, in telling the story to WBZ-TV, said, it was like a sign from God. God put him there to do that mission. Adolfo hopes that others will be inspired to do good works and to offer help when help is needed. And I think inspiring others is part of this scripture message today. I think it's part of what Jesus is saying. Though you have to know a little bit about chemistry, right? Salt and light. After grad school, I took a nutrition class, and I have to tell you that I learned so much in that class at UMass Boston. I've been able to preach on it a few times. Let me tell you what I learned in that nutrition class. I learned that water chases salt, right? Anybody who fries eggplant, what do? You slice it up and you throw salt on it. Why? To draw out the water, right? Before you fry it, so it's not all, you know, splattering. Okay. So, and I can't be the first person to make this analogy, but I couldn't find it in any commentary that I looked in. So, you are the salt of the earth. Water chases salt. You obviously know that if you've ever eaten a bag of chips. Has anybody else ever eaten a whole bag of chips? I have. Right, because you're bloated, right? Water chases salt. So there's that. And then you are the light of the world. What happens to plants with light? They bend toward the light, right? They go toward the light. I know this because I have a Norfolk pine at home, and it's getting tall. It's 20 years old. When it starts bending toward the light, I turn it around, and it starts bending the other way, so it goes back straight. So inspire others, and they will follow you. If we are salt and light, others will follow us. Salt and light don't exist for themselves. They have real-life applications. Friends, we don't exist for ourselves. We have real-life applications. And Jesus said, a city built on a hill cannot be hid. And yet here we are, top of Meeting House Hill. And what goes on here is still largely hidden from the world. Why? Because in Maine, only 5% of people are affiliated with any religious organization. 5%! 95% of the people driving by have no idea what goes on in here. So we have a great opportunity to take the church out into the community. So I want you to think about how God has worked through you, and this is your holy homework. Think about how God has worked through you and be brave enough to talk about it. Let your light shine. And if you're still finding your light, still finding your faith, that's cool too. Be like some of the brightest stars in the sky. Be like some of the brightest planets in the sky. They are reflecting the light of the sun. And you can do that too. Only this time we're going to spell it S-O-N. Blessed be. And amen.
Today's choral anthem invites some congressional participation. During our anthem today, there will be parts where you're invited to sing with us, and I wanted to teach you that part now. The words are pretty simple. It's taste and see the goodness of the Lord, and we do that twice. So let me just go ahead and do section by section, and I'll teach it to you, and then we'll sing with the choir. So the first part is taste and see, and it sounds like this. Taste and see, let me have everyone join in that little phrase there. Let's try that together. Here we go. Ready? Go.
Taste and see, taste and see.
The next part, the goodness of the Lord, sounds like this.
The goodness of the Lord.
Let's try that together. Ready? Go.
The goodness of the Lord.
You guys sound great. Let's try the whole thing together. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Taste and see.
If you just add the word oh, it sounds like this.
Oh, taste and see,
let's try that.
Oh, taste and see, taste and see.
And the final part is the goodness of the Lord, and it sounds like this.
The goodness of the Lord, of the Lord.
Let's try that together. Here we go. come to choir on Wednesday. Let's all do the whole thing. This is the full chorus here.
Taste and see.
Turning and facing you during our anthem, we are going to be inviting you to sing with us, and then for the verses, I'll turn back and we'll sing some more.
Taste and see.
this time I invite the spiritual life and worship team to bring the communion elements forward, please. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus sat in an upper room with his disciples. They had just finished the meal, and Jesus took bread, and he first gave thanks to God, and he blessed the bread, and he broke it. And he said, "Take and eat this, all of you. This is my body given for you, and as often as you do this, do so in memory of me." And in a similar fashion, when the supper had ended, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks to God. And he blessed it and he said, this is the cup of salvation, the cup of forgiveness, the cup of the new covenant. And it's poured out for you and you and you and for many. Take and drink from it. And as often as you do so in memory of me. Gracious, loving God, send forth your Holy Spirit to bless these elements, the bread and the cup, that by taking them in, we take in Christ's teachings, we take in his peace, we take in his love, that we are able to share that with the world. In his holy name we pray. Amen. And now, ministering to you in his name, we offer you the bread of life and the cup of the new covenant. Take and eat, take and drink.
Hello, my name is Chris Kiter. Would you please join me in the unison prayer of thanksgiving? Lord Jesus, we thank you for refreshing us at your table. As the bread and the juice nourish our bodies, may this holy act of communion nourish our souls. Be with us as we go about our daily lives and show us the way. Help us to light the path for others so that we may all know your peace and your love. Amen. Our closing hymn today is "This Little Light of Mine," number 364 in the Red Hymnal.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This
Wow, that was great. We should do that all the time. For announcements today, today we have heard about being salt and light. We let our light shine by doing good work in the world. I want to start by thanking you for your donations of, one, diapers to benefit Greater Portland Family Promise, and two, Valentine cards for the Care and Connection team to send out to those in and beyond our community. One big way that we shine our light into the community is through our children's clothing closet. We've been sending items to new mothers at the Northern Lights Birthing Center, and your donations of items for newborns to three-month-olds would be appreciated. Also, we are always getting requests for children's coats and snowsuits. We know that salt both preserves and enhances. Friendships and opportunities to be together can both preserve and enhance our lives. Excuse me. The Fellowship Club will gather this Tuesday night for dinner and a music program featuring Terry Foster and Lorraine Boland. The dinner is $18, and you must reserve your meal today, Sunday, February 5th, with Lynn L. or Walter J., or by emailing the office at office@fccucc.org. And finally, please know that your offerings are an important part of the salt and light and energy of this church. You may make your offerings in person in the box at the back of the sanctuary, or by mail sending a check to 301 Cottage Road in South Portland, Maine, or online at fccucc.org and pressing the donate button. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris. All right, friends, you've heard me say it already once today, so I'm going to invite you to say it with me this time, okay? Let's do it together. Friends, I wish you lots of peace today and always. Go forth to live the light, to give the light, and to bring heaven to earth every single day. Go in peace. Amen.